money for things, guys, but they may not be invested. My vendors aren't invested like I am. My partners, they're invested in my success. So that's another thing. I don't think on my own I could have built. I know for a fact I couldn't build what I'm building without my partners in place. That's just simple. Simple as that. Yes, farther back. Sweet. What's your name?
I'm David.
Hi, David.
I'm Neha.
You mentioned you've been an overachiever, and how much of that do you think has to do with just the, DNA of who you are, and how much do you think it has to do with actually building habits throughout your life that make you more of a hard worker than 99% of everybody else?
Okay, great question. So the question is, and rephrase it for me if I got it wrong. As an overachiever, how much is that based on DNA versus actual habits? I mean, I will say it's DNA. I got some really good genes here and there. My dad went to IIT. Any Indians in the house will know it's twice as hard as getting into than Harvard. So I got some good brain genes in there. My mom's also sharp cookie. She's street smart. She has that hustle. So I'm a combination of hustle, brains, and visionary. My dad is definitely a visionary. So I do think DNA matters. I do think DNA matters. I will say, though, I do also believe it's not just DNA. Let me explain why it's not DNA. I grew up in a family with 9 girl cousins. Yes, there's 9 of me. Can you imagine? And 1 boy. Doesn't really matter. He's kind of lost and confused with the 9 of us. What I will tell you is, even if you have the genetics and the DNA, and even if you have the capital, you can still be a lazy ass. I'm not going to name names in my family, because I'll get in a lot of trouble.
This is the boy.
You know the boy, so I'm not going to say that. No, it's not the boy. Anyways, what I will say is, you can still be lazy. It does come down to habits. It also came down to the standards that I was raised in. See, I don't know if anyone grew up with Indian parents or parents in general that were like, if you can make an A minus, Neha, you can make 100. Where are the other 3 points? Why'd you bring home a 97? I mean, if you can make a 97, you can make 100. This is a careless error. So, like I said, stress and anxiety, my parents still, my mom's like, I never put pressure on you. Are you freaking, do you have amnesia? So she just chooses to forget the kind of stress I was under. But it was also like self-pressure, right? Like I told her, I dream about my business, I sleep, I think about it on the drive here. I'm like, I think about it constantly, right? So I would say there's definitely a lot of habits in place. 1, I take care of this. If this thing isn't in check, and I start to feel a little ugly, I don't perform as well. So my body has to be like in check. My mind has to be in check too. It's a big deal. The way you, everything that happens between these 2 ears can determine if you are a 6-figure business, 7-figure business, or $1 billion. It all happens right in fucking here. If you can't get a check on this, guys, am I allowed to use this language?
No, you're not allowed to use it.
I'm just curious. I'm like, I'm not sure if I'm allowed to use this language or not. And I'm just using it clearly affiliated. I think it's because you guys are young. Usually I talk to parents. And the energy in the room is very like hot, so I'm just like, okay, I can just be me. So I would say that habits are a huge part of it. Like I said, I am a hustler. Like, straight up, I'm a hustler. Okay, so I focus on things that are revenue generating. If I start to see things not going well, I'm picking up the phone, I'm calling, I'm doing all those calls, like making sure we close business. Habits are so key. I don't think it's just DNA, because I've seen people with beautiful genes, great trust funds, and they're really unfulfilled. It's actually really sad. Like when I hear their problems, like, man, I can't lose those last 3 pounds. I'm like, really? Kids don't have education, what's wrong with you? Right? Now, I'm just here to tell you that I definitely think it's habits. And it all starts with homework, guys. How you do anything is how you do everything. So not to like call you guys out on that, but I'm gonna call you out on that. Like if you're gonna be a procrastinator, you're going to procrastinate your business. Your business might be at the $2,000 in the account, and you have to wait till it gets to that to find your hustle. That's a problem. You want to hustle no matter what's going on. So habits are everything, and I really do believe how you do anything is everything. I'll tell you why. In order for me to relax, because you can see I have a lot of energy, I like to either paint, dance. I was Miss India, Texas at one point. Texas in the house. I won because of my performance. I won one point halftime for the Rockets. Because my high school is that cool. I was part of a hip-hop team. So dance relaxes me. Art relaxes me. There's this thing called adult coloring books. Has anyone heard of these? Where, like, you just color these pages? First, I thought they were real stupid. But then I got them. I got some, like, high-end colored pencils. Because anything I do, it has to be really nice. Like, I love office supplies, obviously, because I work with kids. I have, like, the most Mac daddy desk with, like, insane amounts of post-its. Just imagine hundreds of colors of post-its on my desk. So I'm sitting there on the plane. This is last weekend. And I'm coloring the sheet. And then I decided to be a little more aware. I'm listening to the voice in my head. It's a beautiful little thing. And I'm like, why can't you get this done? What's taking you so long? Why can't you figure this out? Get this done. Who can we enlist to do this? Let's get mom to start working on this too next to you. And I thought to myself, oh my God. And I'm like, get this finished now. Get it finished. What is the rush, man? It's a colored sheet. It's not going anywhere. So how you do anything is how you do everything. And I remember how to self-talk to myself. Neha, it's okay if you don't finish it. No one's grading it. It's going to be okay. But it's why I'm such an executor. In the last weekend, I realized that really I should brand myself as the project manager for your team on the college admissions process. Because I'm a project manager. I love tasks and I love getting things done. So when you talk about motivation, drive, being an overachiever, being successful, it has a lot to do with what's going on between your head and how you do anything is everything. Anyone else in the back? Yes. What's your name?
Danny.
Dave?
Danny.
Danny and Dave. Okay, got it. Cool. Resumes for people that want to be a tutor on my team a week. 100. I'm really particular. There's a certain branding we have about feeling a little bit like your sibling. So there's a certain kind of look and feel I like my tutors to have. In a way, they have to kind of look and feel like me. They have to be edgy, fun, hot, cool, exciting, energetic, passionate. Oh, you want to look this way? I'll teach you this way. Let's open Khan Academy. Let's do this. Your textbook? Oh, you forgot your textbook? That's too bad. We have the internet, right? Like, our tutors are hungry and excited. So I'm really big on making sure that our tutors are a certain caliber. I'll tell you why. I get a lot of calls from other tutoring companies where moms are like, hey, I worked with X company and they just sucked. I'm like, honey, don't worry. I gotcha. I typically don't expand to anything larger than 25 coaches. Now, probably could. That might be something in here that holds me back at 25. I have some mentors that are like, let's franchise this. Let's grow this here. I'm like, holy moly. I don't want to become the problems that other companies have that aren't boutique feeling, because we are a high-end boutique agency. So yes, it was hard at first. I have a very strict dress code. I mean, if you saw my training videos and like dress code requirements, and like, I like break down how an hour session works, like first 5 minutes, build rapport. Halfway through, tell them they're doing a great job. Like, I have so many structures and systems in place. Like, don't let all of this like fun craziness on the Q&A let you not think that I'm a very process, systematic, driven person. Everything is a system. The way you wake up, it's a system. The way you brush your teeth, like, by the way, you probably brush your teeth the same way. Tomorrow, try to brush your teeth differently. You'll be like, oh, that feels weird. Right, so my onboarding is such a huge part of my business with my tutors. Second thing is I interview them and I can tell within a minute if they're gonna fit. Like, in a minute, I can be like, no. Okay, you know what, thanks for calling. You know what, we'll get back to you back. I don't waste my time anymore. I can tell on the phone, I can tell by their voicemail. crappy voicemail, that email address, like, too hot to quit, too legit to quit, whatever. I'm like, no, I'm not hiring someone who's too legit to quit. I look at their social media pages, like, none of this and none of this is going on with my tutors. If it is, I don't want to know. Shouldn't be public. They're going into people's homes. I background check them. I mean, I am super intense about hiring. So when I decided to scale, it was about finding the creme de la creme. I hired someone recently, decade of experience at Princeton Review. I was like, I'll snatch that from you guys. Premier level trainer. This guy like created curriculum for them. I was like, this guy's the bomb.com. I hired another one. He's like Harvard, UPenn, like rock star. I've hired students from U of H that are amazing. I'm just really picky. That's how I see it. All right. Yes. What's your name?
Randall,
nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So with having all these hats, you have to get overwhelmed sometimes. Probably more often than not. How do you deal with that?
Okay. I'll let you in on a little secret. 2 days ago, I got an email from my right-hand woman to told me she was leaving me. Do you want to know what I did? I just acted like it didn't happen. I was like, not before the month of finals. This is my, we call May our money maker month, okay? This is the end of the year. This is when you need tutoring. Most of you kids might need tutoring too. So I ignored it for like 3 days. That's how I dealt with that. I was like, yesterday I had a conversation to understand her reasons for leaving. And I realized that one of the main reasons she was leaving was we were not on the same page about values and beliefs and scalability in my business. See, we're a growing startup. So if you want to lower the hours you work, that's a problem, baby, because there is so many more hours to be done. And I will tell you, there are times I'm overwhelmed. I will tell you, last night, I was definitely in my little, like, blanket sweater, eating my Chinese food, watching 5 episodes of The Arrangement. Got sucked into that show. But then I got up and I was like, Neha, get your ass off this couch. Get your stuff together. I've already lost 5 people that were my right-hand women in the last decade. This is not a new problem for me. But I will tell you, it hurts. It's like a breakup. My heart hurts. Breakups hurt for both men and women. It's painful. Hearts are broken. Business can feel like that. There are times where clients aren't happy or they want a refund. And I'm like, but I love you guys so much, what's wrong? I've had to learn to become the chief emotional officer of my life. There was a part of me that didn't want to come today. But I still showed up. Because I made a commitment. And you guys are awesome. But I'm here to tell you, yeah, it's painful. For the next 4 weeks, I have to do her work too. Until I find a replacement. And it's in my busy season. And she knows it. It kind of feels like a sword in your back. But you know what? You still have to keep hustling and moving on. And yeah, I get overwhelmed. You know what I do? I go work out. Simple as that. I should get moving, get a little sweat on, be proud of myself. Like, my problems are small compared to the world's problems, right? Like, there are kids not getting education. Get up and get out of your own world. So the overwhelmedness does come, and I'm not going to say that it doesn't exist, and I do sit in it, and sometimes I do cry. Like, crying is very normal in my life. If you guys have ever read about it, I'm a highly sensitive person. I became aware of that in the last year and a half because I feel things a lot more deeply. You know those friends that you're like, why are you crying in every movie? That's me. Or like, why are you so cheesy in a relationship? That's me. Like, I feel everything and I'm just a feeler. So yes, I do get very overwhelmed. And there are days where I'm like, why are you scared? Why don't we just work with the people that are happy? Let's just focus on the happy people and let's just not grow anymore. But I'm here to tell you that overwhelm and entrepreneurship are like hand in hand. If you can't manage that, get out. Like, get the hell out, because it is so hard. That's why I started my presentation as CEO. And I thought about that this morning when I was looking at my slides. I was like, I gotta include this part because no one talks about it. You guys are just reading stuff on like Inc. magazine. Someone's like, oh my God, I scaled. It's so awesome, 5 million a year. You guys, entrepreneurship is not all of what's on the covers. I'm like here to tell you and like break it to you because overwhelming is a crippling feeling, but it's also why I've done so much personal development with Tony Robbins. Heads up, download his app. If you can't get your butt to an event, download his app and listen to him, because he's the bomb. There are times where I am in a state of fear, frustration, anxiety. I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can do payroll. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know if I should do this anymore. Why don't I just go sit on a beach again? Like, that was a lot easier. That voice is still there. But then there's that other voice. It's like, Neha, get to a meditation class. Relax a bit. Spend time with your niece on FaceTime. Figure out some of the other things that make you happy outside your business, because entrepreneurship is not the only thing in your life. There are other parts of my life that I love. And that helps with the overwhelm. Great question, Randall. Such a good question. Anyone else in the back on this side of the room? Like the really nice gentleman in green? Oh, he doesn't like being singled out. He's like, why am I getting called on?
I mean, you kind of asked my question. That was mine.
Okay. Sure.
I mean, I liked that, though.
You liked that. Okay. All right, we got some copycats in the room. All right.
Okay, so I've been told by like older people who I've been talking to about entrepreneurship that, oh, like you're a woman, so you're gonna really struggle. Is that true in real world? And how do you know?
Oh my god, I love this question. Such a good one. Okay. Regardless of gender, entrepreneurship's hard. Just a heads up, being a female entrepreneur is definitely interesting. I will tell you one of the best parts about being me, and the most fascinating parts about being me, is that when we launched College Shortcuts online, I had no idea, but I attracted every South Asian female that's half my age. Their moms bought my courses and said, I hope one day my girl can be like you. I was like, that's not why I do what I do, but this is amazing. And I remember I was Skyping with one of them, and I turned on Skype and I was like, oh my god, you look just like me. And she looked at me because we both had our little glasses on, and I took a photo of the Skype call. And I was like, if I were to have a child, it would look like this. Like, that's how much my avatar has been so selected down. I couldn't believe that we were serving on our online course side, like, literally, like, little versions of Neha. Guys in the room may not like this comment. I think female entrepreneurs have a little leg up. I'll tell you why. It's okay. People get bothered by this, but I don't mind ruffling feathers. I've actually learned that I'm okay if you don't like me. That was a big one, guys. Get ready to not be liked. That was a hard one for me to take. Dissonance, get them off your email list, say bye, because I got my fucking tribe and they love me. Let me tell you the best part about being a female entrepreneur. When I'm in business, I slay. I bring out the masculine energy, and I'm like, do you want tutoring or not? Do you want to make a change or not? It's up to you. You want your kid to still make D's? That's fine. But I also bring the heart in, and I'm like, you know what? I was there too. And I love you, and I love your kid, and we're going to do this together. Like, even if your husband's not helpful, like, you and I are a team. So I have to say, there's something to be said. This is why they say that companies are much more successful with higher levels of executives that are female, because we have something called empathy. And men do have it too. I've met some very nice gentlemen that are very empathetic as well. But there's something to be said about the way we use language, we talk more, okay? Some customers want to talk a lot. I serve the female industry. Most of my team members on the internal side, maybe not my tutors, but my internal side, most of us are females. We get our customer really well. I'm sorry someone's telling you that. That makes my blood boil. And I'll tell you why. So many people have said to me when I've spoken or in general, they're like, I never pictured a CEO that looks like you. And I was like, you know what? I'm so lucky because my mom was one. I have the model for myself. So I will tell you that, like, don't let gender be an issue. If anything, you guys are growing up in, like, a totally different age than even when I did. Like, guys, I was, like, in high school when 9/11 happened. You know, like, you guys are growing up in such a different age than we are. And, yes, it was a lot harder being a female. Actually, it was harder being a female in the corporate world, which is also a major reason why I became an entrepreneur. I couldn't find the work-life balance. Work-life balance. I wasn't seeing situations in corporate corporate world where women could happily go to work, happily have children, happily be able to take time off when needed, go to all the soccer games, attend honor roll, and take vacations whenever they want. America's just not set up that way. Maternity leave is short, you might lose your job. I was like, screw it. If this is what the trajectory looks like from a corporate standpoint, I'm gonna have to pave my own path. Because as a woman, for me, family is super important if and when I have one. And I wanna make sure that I have so much flexibility and freedom that anytime something happens with my family, I'm there on a plane, and it doesn't matter because I can work from anywhere. So I will say that I had a harder time corporate being a female because I just am not I'm a little outside of the box. As a lot of people just are surprised when they meet me because they have some stereotypes or notions about who I am. And then I start talking, they're like, whoa, oh my gosh, that's a lot coming out of that 5'1" girl, right? So funny enough, I've had more success being a female entrepreneur. Do you know most tutoring companies are run by males? The top heavy hitters nationally are male entrepreneurs. In Houston, most are males. I know all of them. And they're all like, man, how do you relate to your clients so well? I'm like, oh, because I love on them. I send them flowers. I know how women work. It's not hard. They're like, why would we send them flowers? I was like, because women love flowers. You know what I mean? So yeah, I will say, all the females in the room, actually, there's an event going on in May 10th or May 12th. Cheryl Sandberg's coming to Houston. You guys should Google that. I'm going to that event. Really excited about that. But yeah, I'm so sorry. Get new mentors. Any new questions? Any other questions? Yes.
One more. That's it.
While you were traveling the world,
yeah.
Were you doing that purely for like relaxing purposes, or was it like a business trying to get like a span of like global expansion type stuff?
Great question. A little bit of both. I got a little burned out launching my first company, and I was getting to the point where, and I also really love to travel and go around the world, and I also, like I said earlier, you are who you spend time with. I also got really into this like little weird subsection community of people that are called digital nomads, where you don't have anything but a carry-on or a suitcase, and you just travel around and work from any place that has Wi-Fi. And so I got kind of like sucked into this group of people, which was like 98% men, great ratio for us females. And it was fascinating. So I ended up just traveling because I was with other entrepreneurs that were like-minded that ran internet businesses, and it was kind of the first time, because I was just in hustle mode at my desk, and sometimes I don't get out. Like, I will just keep working. And I ended up attending a conference, and then I just ended up really going out there and meeting all these entrepreneurs. So that is the main reason why I was traveling. It was more of being around camaraderie, because sometimes you need people that are like you. For an entrepreneur, you're not normal. Sorry, you're just not normal. And second, I also love traveling the world. So it was a result of burnout. It was also a result of meeting other like-minded individuals. So thank you so much, guys, for having me.